On 4 Now, a queer street success story from Manchester.
I'm Chris Payne. I'm head of Manchester City Advertising. I have a passion for Manchester's lesbian and gay village, and I want to share that with you.
I still need you there beside me, no matter what I do, for I know I'll never find another you.
The village has been somewhere that has grown out of just a couple of bars into some 30-odd businesses. Clubs, bars, pubs, restaurants, shops. It's been a positive thing that's grown upwards and outward. And it's just taken off. So importantly, we now have a community centre right in the heart of the city where lesbians and gay men can not only party, but they can work and they can live as well.
It's a long, long journey.
Theatres, the restaurants, both inside and outside the village, all feel the positive effect of Manchester having a strong, vibrant, out, positive gay scene. Manchester doesn't compete with London. Manchester competes with Amsterdam, with New York, with San Francisco, with Sydney, with Berlin. A new Jerusalem is being built, coming out of the old cotton mills of the north of England, and our lesbian and gay village is a major international community. We welcome everybody to it.
For I know I'll never find another you.
I think that the whole gay village is about creating the sense of a movement. What that movement seems to be about is creating a separate gay identity, which is very distinguishable from being straight, but which doesn't allow for much individuality within it. And that just seems to entrench homosexuality in the ghetto.
Gay people tend to demand higher standards, won't put up with tacky backstreet clubs any longer, and they've developed new clubs, new venues that are fashionable, they're comfortable.
We've always had to struggle against everyone isolating us and putting us in corners and discriminating against us. And the idea of having a village of people coming together is nice, isn't it?
I wouldn't choose to go and live somewhere that doesn't have a gay life. I'm a gay man, therefore I want to live in an area where I can go out and meet friends and meet people. A lot of gay people have moved to Manchester because of the scene in Manchester. And London, which has a much bigger scene, there's no sense of community. The gay village created that sense of a belonging, and therefore people came. And it's quite unique in many ways. There's almost nowhere else in the UK with it. And people in Manchester are very proud of it. They do feel they belong.
Gay rights has really made huge strides over the last 10, 15 years or so. And an awful lot of what you see around us at the moment is an example of a very, very confident gay village where most people around here are confident and, you know, reasonably secure. So what better time to take criticism?
Krakatan.
Yes, tonight's word features Boy George and Margarita Krakatan.
Yep, on the eve of their special Manchester concert, we find out why George loves this.
You're listening to The Word on KISS 102, Manchester's guide to who's where and when. I'm Mark Ovenden. A new Manchester group are basing their 90s...
Moved up here from the south about 6 years ago, and ever since I've been here, I've had a brilliant time. I think it's a brilliant city. It's got a lot of vitality, a lot of energy. The people want to try and do things, and that's brilliant. I think it's a really good place to be. I saw a map after the bomb when the architects called it the village. They couldn't bring themselves to transfer the word gay onto it, which is a bit of a shame.
The gay village is attracting in a whole range of new people who probably wouldn't have necessarily thought of leaving, say, for example, London, to try any other areas out. It's had a really good press, it's got a lot of support from the council, and it's really growing. And it's actually worth coming to. Quite a lot of people who experienced Old Compton Street think that the gay village in Manchester is better than Old Compton Street, because although there's perhaps not quite so many things and quite the variety as there is in London, it's all in one place, it's dead friendly, and it's dead up front.
Well, I like the way this is sounding.
Great hopes are invested in the gay village. The gay village is seen as leading the way. I think this is a national, if not international, view that the sort of the great economic success of gay enterprises is showing how sort of cities that have been undergoing recessions can regenerate. If you have the money, you can go out in reasonably nice surroundings.
The whole sort of gay bohemian sort of exotica tag that goes along with being gay is something which is highly marketable. It is a very good way of regenerating a part of the city that, up until a few years ago, was a bit down a heel. APN is the leading What's On guide to the gay scene in the north outside of London, because obviously a lot of the London-based publications don't find life outside London particularly interesting. I don't know why.
After the demonstrations against Clause 28 in Manchester in 1988, Manchester felt very confident. It brought lots of people in to the city from outside. Manchester is still a glorious city that is coming alive again and again and reinventing itself. And the City Council sees the gay village as an integral part of that. It also recognises that the village charities Mardi Gras are positive for the city. Here we are in the visitor centre, and the professional gay-friendly staff are here to answer any questions that we have about what's going on in Manchester for lesbians and gay men. So over to yourself.
This is a really good map about the gay village. It has a number of the places that people can visit, but it isn't just about bars and that kind of stuff. There are other things as well, the village charity, other sort of social groups, that kind of thing. So it's more than just having a good time, though the emphasis is, if you like, on just the leisure side.
Ostrich.
Ostrich.
Grilled ostrich with pate.
And port sauce. Dip.
Pate and port sauce, right, thanks. I've worked in Manchester for a long time, but originally I did come from Stockport. But come 17, 18, I thought that there was more out there. So I used to come down to Manchester city centre.
One constructive point. You know what I'm like, I'm never happy.
Go on.
A bit more black pepper, darling.
Okay, dear.
We used to get a taxi down, and it was like, where are you going? Oh, nowhere, we're just going out for a drink, sort of thing. Well, now, it's like, we're going down to Canal Street, we're going down to the village, and everybody, you know, like, wants to be invited, and the straights try and look gay so that they can get in the venues on Canal Street.
Why do you think that you'd be suited to Metz?
Well, as you said, you've seen me in here before. I just like the atmosphere in here. It's a dead relaxed atmosphere.
Carl knows what Metz is about. He will feel quite comfortable here. He won't feel intimidated by gay people. He knows that the music's right. So that's the main hurdle over with. He's a good-looking young guy.
Show me a catering establishment that's not got a queen in it.
I feel it is important to have good-looking waiters and waitresses. Who wants to be served by an ugly dump, you know? A nice, pretty face always makes your steak more appealing.
Yes, please, for sex. I think we could sort something out on that department.
Yes, I've heard about your reputation.
See you Monday morning, 9 o'clock.
OK, all right. Thank you.
Cheers, thanks a lot.
Some people seem to think everybody's dead after 35. And there's nothing left for them, you know. You're so old, you're ain't you? I saw a boy the other night and he was crying. I said, what are you crying for? He said, I'm 21, I'm past it. I said, you must be joking. 21, past it, you've got the world in front of you. You know what he said to me? He said, but you're very, very ancient. I wouldn't think of going on a Saturday night, for instance, anymore. Because it's so busy and so packed.
That's what I'm saying. And the music, and loud music.
Exactly. And then
people
what is
are
it?
Pushing into you with drinks and cigarettes.
You can't even sit down and have
You can't even hear what you're talking. You've got to shout to be heard.
Yeah.
And then you get bored.
Yes, you want to get home.
You get bored. Who the hell wants to go to the village every night? I'm sorry. Not me.
We met at Lewis's, actually.
Yes. Lewis's.
Lewis's, the big department store department in Manchester. Store. Everybody worked at Lewis's at one time. Yeah. New manager said, I'm going to get rid of the homosexual element in this store. Mm. And another guy stood up and said, what are you trying to do? Make us self-service. I was a demonstrator. I demonstrated the Prestige, the pressure cookers. And we had like a little theatre there with the stage with it.
You were downstairs,
yeah.
You?
And they had like seats for people to sit down and you used to get the pressure cooker on and they were demonstrating the. Until it blew up, the day it blew up, and that's when I got fired.
And I was on cooked meats.
This is going to be able to collect all our psychic energy and we're going to send it right to the ceiling. There's going to be an explosion of energy that only I will feel.
What can you tell me about? Where am I going?
Who drives the red car?
I grew up in Oldham. I was always aware of the fact that there was a gay village. I just thought it was somewhere where people are just coming look for sex. 1, 2, 3.
My man's got
it. Oh, I felt it. Did you?
Did you?
Christine, you felt it. I saw it in your face. Did you feel it?
Yeah, I felt something.
I'm very powerful. It was also a huge letdown my first time. I thought, I don't know what all the fuss is about. I thought it was just a load of rubbish. Saying that, I came every week.
Asked me to do all their body, but they also wanted me to do the nether regions as well. But I said, no, I can't do down there because my hands aren't as steady as they used to be. It's been asked before, but no. I only go down to a certain point.
Oh, can I make an appointment for later?
You 15?
Yeah. I'll see you later.
I would say 80% of my clientele are gay and they specifically come into town just to come and have their hair cut. But whilst they're here, then they'll go and visit all the other gay businesses about, you know, they'll go into Clone Zone, they'll go for a drink, or, you know, if they're going to see the doctor, you know, Tim, who's only round the corner, you know, they'll go and see him and then come into have a haircut.
Why do I get Wales?
Right, do you?
I wanted to say real in perhaps 2 or 3 years.
Right.
Well, you'll be travelling to Australia, without a doubt. I feel Australia right. Okay. Well, I get Paris.
He's obviously talking to a spirit at the moment.
I do get Paris. Are you thinking of moving to Paris? Yeah. No.
Sounds very exotic for you, Australian Paris.
Chanel and Paris. Excuse me, girls. Hello.
Fernando.
Hi, Jane. How are you?
Were you talking to another spirit?
Yeah. I knew exactly what you were going to write. I got a glitter in my eye and I thought, well, Jane's obviously going to phone me.
I'm ringing you because I want you to do a prediction for the village, for the gay village. Are they going to be marauding hordes of straight people rampaging through the village?
Susie, you got a pen? I'm in the middle of a very important phone call.
Well, it's all action here at the moment at the top of Canal Street as we start our guide of the village, looking at both the official and the some of the unofficial spots around Manchester's famous gay village. Here's one of the off-the-record areas, just down here on the Rochdale Canal. It's been known for gentlemen to peruse day and night up and down the canal here for a bit of fringe activity.
I mean, people have, like, picked up in here before, you know what I mean? They usually ask us, well, who was he? You know, and then the next time you see them, you know, they're out
where
together.
Where did he drink? Where
That's
did he go?
That's right, yeah. So we tell them, you know, what their name is, you know. And that, as I say, you know, like you see them a week later and they're together.
Beer Foster, just slightly further down. Been open just over a year now. Again, it's brought a new style of bar into the village. It's got two restaurants-type food bar areas. Done very, very well. Very busy and a success, part of the many different things that make up the village. There is something for everyone. And here on the wall here, we've got a menu, so you can see what's on offer here. Oh, we've got lamb with apricots, a bit of fruit with your meats, Indonesian-style chicken breast. Yes, it has been alleged that I do like a bit of chicken breast, but we'll leave everybody else to think about that one, yes.
Let me just show you exactly what I walked into this morning. Bread and butter pudding. Pudding with 1D. Can I ask you, when did pudding have 1D? All the chair legs haven't been done for 2 days by the cleaners, so they're in for a good bollocking when I see them. They're going to get a right good telling off. I'm not happy. Look at the build-up in there. How can I continue to run the best establishment in the village if things like this are happening?
I've lost the boy, George Byock, but I'm sure to turn up soon. Just try and chuck it down here. I hope I can talk to George about why he's in Manchester. I talked to him briefly about gay Manchester before, and he seems to like it here. He's played Paradise a few times, and he's done a few nights here, which he didn't need to have done, really. So he's obviously quite supportive of the city, and the city loves him as well. So let's hope that he's got a bit to say about it.
It's not. We're now in the heart of the gay village proper on Canal Street, and as you can see here at Prague 5 and the other bars down the street, it's a hive of activity. There's urban regeneration happening in action. This is a classic example of the private and public sector working together to rebuild an inner city area. These are the old Victorian warehouses for which Manchester is famous, which are now being put to work, turned into modern, stylish, exciting bars.
There's a big tendency within Manchester as a whole to feel a great sort of regional pride in the area. But I think it's a matter of being realistic. And, you know, if you make these great claims for it and try and, you know, suggest that it's some incredible cosmopolitan cultural, you know, nexus, it just... people are just going to come and think, my God, what is this? It's a provincial town with grand aspirations.
There's door.
Hiya, I'm just ringing up about the cowboy outfit. Could you tell me how much it is, please?
You're talking £5 hire and £10 deposit.
Right, and does that include everything?
No, the hat and the waistcoat if you want.
So, are you open till 5:30
mm-hmm.
then?
Mm-hmm.
Right, I'll call around later.
Okay. Bye bye.
They don't have the fun that we used to have. I mean, we used to have sort of laughs at. With no money. I mean, nobody did anymore.
No.
Let's be fair. But with a great community spirit and, yeah. and friendship was. If he'd got a quid, we'd all borrow off him. And then
the next
if
night.
I'd got a quid, they'd borrow off me, and it worked like that. Everybody
pulled together.
Being a female impersonator in them days was absolutely an unconventional job because, but there wasn't all that many, you know.
To be shall we say theatrical wise, we'd already come out of the closet.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Whereas other gay boys and girls couldn't come out. Because of the law.
Oh, hello.
Hiya.
What can we do for you?
I came in, was it last week?
Oh, yeah.
For it, that was...
Oh, that's right, yeah, I'll go and get them for you. Yeah.
Which?
It's the Munchkin House.
Mm.
communism meets consumerism in the handover of Hong Kong, fueling China's desire for advanced consumer goods. Some consumers, however, are already one step ahead. Vorsprung Dock Technique, as they whisper in China.
Being single has never been so much fun. Lines are open 24 hours, so call the Singles Network on 0891 808 808.
Breathe erotic spirit.
It's outrageous.
Now find out what that horse is performing next. Nailer.
It's shocking.
So what do you like?
Nothing too painful.
Wife swapping.
Correct.
Blood.
It's fantastic.
One day, I'm going to give you such a spanking.
Preaching to the perverted.
You know, you can put your hair at risk every time you wash it. Surprised? Hair is most fragile when it's wet. Just combing can break it. Pantene Pro-V can help. It actually makes hair stronger, so it breaks less. Pro-Vitamin B5 nourishes at the root and penetrates all the way to the tip. Pantene gives hair a healthy-looking shine and makes it stronger. Pantene Pro-V, for hair that looks so healthy it shines. Stronger hair breaks less.
The average cow passes enough wind in a week to inflate a hot air balloon. 88% of clowns never fall in love. Percent of strippers had a convent education. Every year, over 300 animals escape from zoos and circuses. Percent of Man United fans have never been to Old Trafford. Men think about sex every 6 seconds.
The Argos sale is so great!
I just can't get over it.
Get connected. Call the Gay Network now on 0891 54 54 54.
Originally, the union used to be the American pub, where all the Yanks from Burnwood Aerodrome used to come along here. And then an Irish guy took over, and that's when it became the female impersonators pub of the city. I mean, everybody used to come to the union.
Oh, of course you have. I mean, you can't let people...
I must have been about 16 years old when I first discovered the union. And it, to me, it was like Wonderland. It was an incredible thing in those days to realise that you weren't alone. What you wanted to do was exactly what was being done. There was a nucleus of 5 female impersonators used to work here then, in those days. The guys didn't see you as a man. They saw you as a glamour doll, a bit like Barbie, really, in a sense. It was much slimmer than this, of course. Big blonde hairdo and enormous knockers. And of course they looked at him, my God, what is this? One of my favourite bits in the old days, when we were on stage, there was a song came out in a show called The Flower Drum Song, which was it was called I Enjoy Being a Girl, the song. And we changed the words slightly to make it, it went like this, I enjoy being a girl. Now I flip when a fella sends me flowers, and I drool over dresses made of lace. And I talk on the telephone for hours with a pound of shaving cream upon my face. Oh, I'm strictly a female, female. And the future I hope will be in the arms of some feminine female
all enjoy having a boy dressed as a girl like you. That was one of the songs we used to sing in the old days.
I think without a doubt, one of the most important influences on changing the gay village from the small collection of pubs, some of which have been there for years and years, was the opening of Mantos. There you had a gay venue which had a big glass window. It was right on the street, directly up front. Yes, this is gay, we have a good time, come and enjoy yourselves.
I believe that Manto actually started Canal Street as we know it today. Prior to Manto, there was the New Union on one side and the Rembrandt and a couple of the New York, New York. And then Met came along 2 years ago, and in the last 2 years, there's been an explosion.
I was a prisoner.
Another occasion, for God's sake.
John's birthday.
Hello.
Hello.
John. Oh, 34 stone. There's no way he's 34 years of age. I'd like to think that I'm a really good operator. I like to exceed customer expectation.
You can take him.
Bottle of house champagne, 6 glasses. Thanks, darling. Today would be nice. Love and thirst. I've just driven all the way from the M62. Wow's my baby. The mother's tits. It's no wonder. It's very special, I believe, when you walk in Met. It's very nice. And the music, the candles, and you think, wow, I'm going to have a really good time. And I like to be there to ensure that people go away going, wow. Oh! I went out with Tracy one Sunday, and she got me so drunk that I woke up in Stockport bus station at 10 o'clock next door to a tram, and he offered me a drink!
Metz, in my opinion, has been a complete success, and I could never have hoped that Metz would have escalated into what it has done over the last 2 years.
Things have come on since then, hopefully. Come on, it's your birthday, fill it up.
Generally, Jane, there is a huge grey cloud over the gay scene. Well, these cards talk about being restricted. Mm-hmm. And it's restricted by negative energies coming from outside in. Do you know what I mean? So, ultimately, I'm at the moment unaware of where or of how we're going to rid ourselves of the negative energy.
So these negative energies are going to be coming from without into the heart of the village.
Yeah, but I also feel it's talking
who
about...
Who is bringing these negative energies?
It's people's... our own attitudes, mm-hmm, and gay people's attitudes. That's what... That's who I'm blaming.
Lot of people on the scene who, you know, look pretty similar to each other, and I think that's probably it's come from America, and it's moving to Manchester, and it's moving to all the gay places in the world, really. And maybe that's a bit of a shame, but you know, at least it gets us out of the house and stops us watching Coronation Street.
Don't send him off with your hair still in curlers. You may not see him again.
Anything goes, really, but gay people, as a rule, tend to have their hair cut that bit shorter. You know, I don't... I mean, how long have you had your
hair? It's always been fairly short, yeah, really.
But is that a choice, or is because...
Because I'm careful when it's long, probably. But a lot of gay men tend to have it short, because, like, when they get a bit older, when they get a bit older and it starts to thin, you see, it doesn't really show.
Yeah, it's a look, it's an image.
Run to his arms the moment he comes home to you. He's almost here.
lot of the time, it's just, you know, somebody is seen as being straight or not, or even, in my case, not sufficiently conventionally gay, and therefore seen as a threat, as a problem, as not being sufficiently homogenous. And I think the drive to total homogeneity is one of the most depressing things about, you know, a community which is supposed to be about self-expression.
Better wear something pretty, something you wear to go to the city. And
the problem is for me that looking good in the gay sense is about looking the same as everybody else.
Dim all the lights, pour the wine, start the music, time to get ready for love, time to get ready.
My own prejudices are just about not wanting to fit, not wanting to merge, really, not wanting to give up my individuality, to subscribe to an identity which has been made up by somebody else, basically, which, you know, it doesn't, my own tastes don't accord with, that my own politics don't accord with. You know, there's a whole slot to fit into that I just don't feel comfortable fitting into. And a lot of people say, oh, that's, you know, that's self-hatred. You know, if you don't like Madonna, you must be really unhappy being gay. You know? I can't really be bothered replying, to be honest, to that one, you know.
Is, well, she's kind of me on a kind of bender, really. She's sort of the stuff that I like to do but never do. She's a kind of girly about town. She's kind of shiny and frivolous and kind of likes dressing up and has to go to all the right places. Twinkle kind of evolved from not quite fitting in on that scene, but wanting to, feeling a bit, maybe a bit too old for that sort of thing, or a bit too old to be trendy and wearing little shiny things and little dresses, because I'm not really sort of, well, as you know, I'm not a tiny person.
I like to go to leather bars. So I have to decide what to wear. You have to decide whether you're going to wear leather jeans like these, with a steel belt, or whether you decide to wear your chaps, and whether you wear a cap or not.
We like to try and keep to a strictish dress code, which is leather. As long as someone's actually wearing a leather jacket or an item of leather, then that's okay, they can come in. But any fluffy jumpers or stripy t-shirts and things like that, that's a no-no.
The Word, 15 minutes of who's here, what's on and where to go in Manchester and the North West, with the guide from Saturday's Guardian.
By George, Neil. It's Boy George that we find out why George loves the city. Oh, yeah. So wrap yourself in a feather boa for
The Word.
With him? Mark Ovenden. He's a rarity.
Everything's running late.
Pop star turned DJ rather than DJ turned pop star. He's also been around a long, long time, from poking around the early 80s clubs.
Oh, no,
Russell's really attractive.
I don't know who that is. I don't know who that is. It's the maid. Hi, I've met you before,
haven't I? Yeah, I've done, yeah.
Where do you want me to go? Can we sit
here?
No, I think I'd rather sit in the bowl upright, yeah.
Nice, and goals with Mark now to chew the fat before going on stage at the Apollo this evening.
I wouldn't want to sit in the chair.
Please welcome to The Word, Boy George.
Yeah, I've been here for several years.
Yeah. Is it permanent, the gay village, or is it just once a year?
No, they just wipe it down with a damp cloth and it goes. Yeah. So what do you think of the concept of the gay village idea?
Well, I think in some ways it's unhealthy because it's creating ghettos. And really, ideally, you know, we should just be there like everybody else, and that should be the end of it. But unfortunately, we live in a society that isn't particularly balanced in our favour. I don't like the idea of, like, gay time TV or gay radio, but I'd like to see, you know, just more of a blend, really. Mm. You know, more of a kind of cultural and sexual blend. I don't think we should be kind of sectioned off into our own little corners, because ultimately it makes you... I think it can make you more hated. You know, the more that we become separate as a people, the more people have something to point at and say, well, that's what you are.
From the lesbians on the street is complete frustration at being a woman in the village. I don't see that the men see the women out there.
Are you a lesbian? No, you're not a lesbian. Are you gay? Fantastic.
It's become very much a straight environment, and that's when I start to suffer, my friends start to suffer, the people that I don't even know. I'll hear comments on a Saturday night going, well, I don't understand what's going on. Why can't we go into that bar? It's straight, but I thought this was a gay village. What's happened? And they'll start to feel pushed out of that. And that's when it feels intimidating. And I know when you think about, oh, it's too easy to say, oh, it's a safe space. And what's happened in the last few weeks, I've noticed little posters have gone up. It's like, it's quite, little posters, this is a gay space, please respect it. It's like, what is that all about? What, you shouldn't have to put little posters up.
I like integration, but saying that, I do like certain specific places to go to that I know are gay, you know, so I can know I can escape to there. You know, it's nice going into mixed places, but, you know, it's nice going to a place where you know that it's 100% gay, you know. I mean, you can be yourself there.
Utopia must be a situation where there will be no difference between gay and straight, and you'd go anywhere. And in fact, you wouldn't need bars specifically for gay men. That you could go and talk to a man, any man, and if you decide to go to bed with each other, the person says no, either because he's straight or because he doesn't fancy you, but wouldn't take offence at the situation. But that's a long way off.
Are you gay?
Yeah.
You are?
Yeah.
Are you gay? Are you gay?
No.
Are you gay?
No.
Are you gay?
You're not.
Are you gay?
Yeah.
No.
You're not.
No.
Are you gay?
No, I swing both ways.
Right. Are you gay?
What is gay?
Are you gay?
No, I'm not.
Are you gay?
What do you think? What's normal?
I'm asking you.
No.
No. Are you gay?
No.
Are you gay?
What's he doing this for?
Oh, sorry, I'm not. No. I can't. Sorry.
I think things are gradually changing in the gay village, and obviously there is, every time something new opens, you have another worry over how straight the villages are becoming. So there's always going to be a concern, I think, that there are too many venues and they're going to bring too many straight people in. But my feeling in it is that actually they do a lot of good, and most of the straight people who come into the village are really impressed and want to be part of it and don't want to cause trouble.
This is our chance, though, to help educate many of the straight people that come into the village. About gay people. They actually find that they're really very interesting. They're not limp-wristed queens. They are interesting people with interesting lives, with a whole variety of different backgrounds. And a lot of people, I think, get very pleasantly surprised when they come into the gay village and talk to gay people.
The original intention of, you know, creating some spaces that were just simply safe has sort of been forgotten, partly because it's not quite so necessary, but partly just because I think the profit motivation has taken over, really. And so it's just become about something very different, and now I think it's just habit. Like, the gay isn't about, being gay isn't about who you sleep with these days. Being gay is about the type of lifestyle you have. And so the gay lifestyle, as prescribed by the gay media, very specifically, involves going to exclusively gay areas where there are exclusively gay bars and hanging out with exclusively gay clientele. That is gay, being gay in the 90s as we know and hate it.
The gay village is building and burgeoning, and at the same time, you see some kind of negative development in the future.
But don't you think that gay people should feel comfortable everywhere? There shouldn't be a need for it.
Oh, absolutely, yeah. So we want assimilation, we want mixing, we want...
We want progression.
Thank you.
Clio Paris and the Clio Provence. Perfect for town and country pursuits.
Papa?
Come.
The Clio Collection from 6995 on the road. For the world's greatest fighters, there is no greater challenge. Jean-Claude Van Damme, The Quest. The FX Performer from Wilkinson Sword. A razor that combines three different parts which flex to follow your individual features for a close shave that's now so comfortable. Shaving becomes a pleasure. The FX Performer from Wilkinson Sword.
Don't punch it, kick it. In the goal, not over it. Put him down the line. Now on your head, Troy.
Sometimes you're just not yourself. With refreshing still spring water and natural fruit juice, Oasis, get you back to your old self.
0-0 on last minute, and England have a penalty. On step Southgate.
Oh. Oasis, open pour for yourself once more.
Disco album in the world ever. 44 of the greatest disco anthems ever made.
Side down, boy, you turned me.
A huge double album packed full of the best disco ever. It can only be the best disco album in the world ever.
For men on the move, men like you, men in touch with other men, dial 0891 34 34 34 and make contact with men you'd like to know better. With Gay Exchange, you choose the service you want. Relay chat, one-to-one private conversations or voicemail messaging, which means you're online whether you're in or out. Thousands of guys call Gay Exchange every day, so call now and make contact with the right men right here, right now.
I feel as if I'm quite lucky to have been able to buy a place in the city centre and right on the doorstep of the Gay Village. I think it's a really nice thing and I like living here. You just have to look out the window and you can see the queue at Manto's and think, oh, it's gone down, I'll nip over now, which is quite nice.
We'll build a world of our own that no one else can share.
10 years ago, there was only like 300 people lived in the whole of the city centre of Manchester. There's now going to be 10,000 people living, you know, in the city centre by the turn of the century, which is fab.
Peace of mind when we live in a world of our own.
Gay identity has become very commodified and has presented a lot of opportunities for people to make a lot of money. The gay scene has come through a kind of weird process to be about money and image and things that ultimately benefit the sort of capitalist world.
I just can't imagine any worse way to live, to be honest. I'd be sort of driven crazy by the endless sounds of happy house music bursting through the walls. And the other thing is just that I think within about a week, everybody in the entire block would just be, you know, wearing exactly the same clothes and have exactly the same hairstyle.
We also now do have some power and muscle with the Pink Pound, but I think what's been important in Manchester is that the business community, the commercial side, the pubs and clubs, have always worked hand in hand with the community groups because they recognise that without change and without fighting for our rights or fighting against those who want to take away what rights we have, that their businesses would go down the drain.
Gay politics has very much become very conservative and about not really challenging the fundamental structures of society. These days it just wants to blend in. And so gay politics as they are at the moment settles very happily with gay business and the whole economic argument. They're very happy bedfellows.
People who are involved in community groups and those kind of things who just see it as a exploitation of the Pink Pound.
Well, I can understand why they think of it like that, but, you know, unfortunately, we live in the late 1990s, under capitalism, we can't change it. I think they've done quite a good job, given the limitations.
It all comes down to money. We've all got bills to pay at the end of the day. We've all got, you know, we've all got to pay the brewery for the barrelage, we've all got to pay wages, we've all got to pay... Unfortunately, it does come down to money.
I'm not getting the meat on time, love. It's just not happening. Promise me faithfully, 10 o'clock. My lamb arrived at 11:05.
And his chicken's
now
still not arrived.
I've not had a chicken for years, love. What do you mean?
When they initially asked me to set up Mets in Liverpool, I was really, really flattered. It was like, wow, fantastic. Perhaps we can start a little village in Liverpool. I remember coming home that night thinking, am I doing the right thing? I am really going to miss the village, because it's got a very special place in my heart.
You have the lighting arrangement here specially so as it shows the grey.
I'm going to take it round the ears and take some of the weight out here, and we'll take a little bit off there.
Yes.
OK, now.
I'm beyond the age where I have anything fashionable done, I'm afraid.
You have your own individual style, don't you, Tim? So this is a Dr. Tim trim.
Well, I was considering renting space, and they said, well, you're the sort of business we want to have in this part of town because we want to clear a lot of the riffraff out. And I think they thought they were moving into an area that was up and coming because the queers were moving out, right?
I can't at the moment, no.
It's no good having a commitment to trendy, expensive cafe bars and fashionable nightclubs and so on if people are coming to tell you that the city council can't sort out the fact that their neighbours are harassing them for their sexuality, or if people are coming to tell you that they actually got quite severely damaged, either physically or at least emotionally, by the police raiding the nightclubs they happen to be using. I think
with the council and the police, it's more on the PR side. I mean, the big events that go on, big gay events, they're there, you know, supporting it, and then you don't see them.
The charity started by people in the gay village, mostly gay business people. And it was the gay community's response to HIV in Manchester. This year we're going to raise something in the region of £250,000. A lot of that, of course, is in cash. Therefore, it all has to be counted. And Mardi Gras, we need a complete team of people in the counting house.
£6,000!
People are not doing it for any glory or self-glamour. They're doing it because they want to do it, they're committed to it. There's very few privileges. We pay for our own sandwiches.
Manchester Council recognises that the village charities Mardi Gras, which this year brought 80,000 people into the village, are positive for the city.
The village charity is 5 years old.
And it raises Manchester's profile. Manchester as a city does not have a problem was shouting loud and proud about its gay village.
It must be a Mardi Gras!
Hello! Mardi Gras is a sort of object lesson in gayness, in my opinion. Gay culture spends a lot of time, pretty exhaustively and exhaustingly, celebrating itself. If you look at something like the video of Mardi Gras, all you really take away from it is a bunch of people having a good time and feeling really proud of having a good time. And I'm not quite sure, having a good time, great, you know, go for it. But I'm not quite sure why it's something that's meant to make everybody feel so good. Mardi Gras simply says about Manchester that it's all about clothes and drinking and dancing.
I've not got a clue what's happening this evening, unfortunately. I've been told to be at Mets by 8 o'clock and will be available by 8 o'clock. I've got a Bentley picking me up from then and I've not a clue. It could be 12 of us having a dinner, people I've worked with in the village for the last 2 years, or knowing Mets, it could be wild.
I know it's one of these roads just off here somewhere, but not sure where we are. I think it's back there, Joe, actually.
What I thought is I'd wear this little number, which is my little P
PVC number, which I can just about squeeze into. It's quite fabulous. It's just a sort of zip.
So, it's decision time, and I'm not sure what I'm going to wear. This is the one that I was thinking of tonight. It's from Aspecto. It's Catherine Hamlet. Very nice.
I'll be going out with my mobile because I'll have to phone people when I get there.
These are quite nice. These are moleskin. And the black and the blue might go quite well.
I once went in a big shoe shop in the city, Saxon, and I wanted a particular pair of shoes to match an outfit. And I kept on and on and on to the assistant showing me all these things. And eventually the manager came across, and because I was sat there, I was a drag, trying these ladies' shoes on. And he just said, how much are you prepared to pay? And I said, £1. He said, take them, £1, get out of the shop. So I got these shoes, which was 25 quid at the time. I got them for a quid. Sorry? Oh, wait. Excuse me. Do you know where Beverley Road is, please?
It's either the second or third one down here. It's down here on the left, anyway.
It's second or third, right, yeah. Thank you.
My hair never goes right on the most important occasions. It always goes one way or another or looks too stiff or... So, but it don't look too bad tonight. Well, I'm sure it'll look a lot worse at 1 o'clock.
Good evening. Good how evening. Are you? Nice how to you see
doing?
You. How are you keeping? All right, love.
Oh, thank you.
Thank you. That's lovely.
Oh,
at last for you. Hey, gang. How are you? All right, love. Nice to see you.
I've still not got a clue what's happening. I'm hoping it's not going to be too much of an emotional night.
I'll tell you what, just you get all of that, squeeze it like that. My turn now. I never bloody get away with that guy,
a quiet, intimate meal for 5 or 6 then. I take it that's not happening.
I'm Twinkle, I should be on the guest list.
There isn't a guest list to get on with tonight.
Oh, there isn't a guest list.
A big hand, ladies and gentlemen, for, of course, our star of this evening.
Polly did say, you know, just come down and that wouldn't be a problem. Apparently it is a problem.
We've got lots of things going on throughout the night. Lots of people coming in to see Polly.
I can't let anyone go to the street door.
Well, how about, I don't know, like 10 quid?
Channel 4, look at right.
Well, why don't you ring Polly?
Right, okay. Right, I'm gonna ring Polly and, It's not a real phone. Got it from Woolworths, £3.99.
Ladies and gentlemen, to the Queen of Mets, and I'm sure the Queen of Liverpool, Pauletto, ladies and gentlemen, the lovely Pauletto.
You all love him. Can you please welcome back the one and only, the fabulous Mr. Bonnie Lewis?
Is it good?
Fabulous.
Oh, it makes it worse, doesn't it?
Mainly of all, I'd like to thank my mum because she has been the main inspiration to me. So I'd like you all to raise your glasses.
We have all these institutions from bar owners to the gay media who spend a lot of time making great claims for what they're doing as if they're some sort of like worthy moral community initiative. Whereas I think, you know, all these things are just businesses. Where that becomes a problem is where you're expected to make special exceptions for these businesses and, you know, have different rules for them because they're somehow worthier.
I'm much more concerned about inequality of wealth than I am about inequality of sexual status. As far as I'm concerned, you know, homosexuality boils down to a series of acts, and I don't see why, just because you indulge in those acts, that you have to take on a whole lifestyle and culture.
So much has been negative to lesbians and gay men over thousands of years. So why don't we praise something that is working reasonably well, and where it isn't working, that we've got the openness and frankness to say we can make this better. We have something that many other cities do not have. And whilst I won't turn a blind eye to things that need to be improved, let's not knock something that is doing well.
I think people in Manchester are very proud of the gay village. They see it as unique. They see it as giving them an advantage. And that's why they... I don't think it's there, actually. There's no one gone round and told them, this is what you must say. I think people are saying, I am proud of being part of the gay life in Manchester.
Land of hope and glory, mother of the free, how shall we extol thee? Oh, I'm born of thee.